mission to find out how I can live a more sustainable life. I've already looked at the ways I might be able to power my own commute in the future, and also at the future of food on a large industrial scale. But it's not all about food. There must be other little things I can do inside my own home. I appreciate that I alone can't make changes that are going to affect climate change on a global scale, but I should be able to make tweaks in my own environment. So I've come to Lammas Eco Village in Wales to see how they live. So at the moment, we are in one of your polytunnels,
yeah,
which is where you're growing a lot of your food. Are you completely self-sufficient with your own food?
If there was a zombie apocalypse next week, yeah, we wouldn't go hungry. You know, but we'd be bored of turnips and swedes and stuff like that, but
right,
that's okay.
Do you find that you're growing a larger variety of food here?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, totally. And crops that don't normally make it to the supermarket because they just don't necessarily work. I mean,
right,
you know, mizuna is a really, really good example. You know, it's a fantastic green. It's a lovely, slight peppery flavour. Very easy to grow, but it doesn't keep.
It?
Yeah. Just doesn't keep. So if you were to pick that and take it to the supermarket, it would wilt. It just wouldn't be presentable. So there's a lot of crops that people traditionally grew or people grow that you don't find in the shops.
I'm going to keep snacking on this. You've had to do a lot of work to make sure the soil is rich and nutritious.
Mm.
How have you done that here, naturally?
Through harvesting biomass and building compost.
Mm-hmm.
You know, kind of moving things around. Just look at it like that. I take my recycled cardboard and then I mix it with manure from the cows or the goats, and then I mix it with garden weeds, and I mix it all up and aerate it, and then I build soil or compost.
So actually the animals aren't just providing you with dairy and meat, but they're a huge part of the things you're growing as well in the ground.
Totally. The main purpose of the animals is to help me with the land management. The goats, cows, they graze and then bring the nutrients up to the barn where they produce the black gold for me. Yeah.
Okay.
The
black gold.
Yeah, yeah. the geese, they graze the orchard, keep the grass down in the orchard. That keeps the apple trees healthy. The ducks, they roam the vegetable garden, eating the slugs and the snails and any other insects that might damage my crops.
And how are you ensuring that you waste as little as possible?
Anything organic just part of the becomes part of the cycles.
Right now you've got a full polytunnel worth of food. If you were living in the city, you were living in an urban area, like, is this possible? Is this achievable?
It's totally achievable. You just got to replicate it on a small scale.
Mm-hmm.
You know, anybody could be growing this in a window box just outside their window.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or if you've got a garden, just in a little cold frame or, you know, a tiny little greenhouse, anybody could be growing food.
How do you manage your energy here?
Well, we have three systems. Mm-hmm. We've got a solar panel on the roof, and that runs the LEDs around the house. And then we have a hydro system, which is constant. That's always flowing as long as there's river water happening.
Okay, so if it rains a lot, then that's going to be busier and generate more electricity.
Winter, we have more than enough electricity. We were so lucky, the turbine was actually here before we moved here.
Oh, bonus.
So it was just a matter of hooking it in and getting it moving again. And then we also have a solar rig as well. So we have a 1.5 kilowatt solar rig. I mean, an interesting little meter that we have in the house. It's called an owl. It's just like this little meter.
Mm.
You plug it in or tune it into your electric consumption, and it tells you at any given time how many watts you're burning. And both my kids are completely watt savvy.
I love this idea of being watt savvy. The fact that we should be aware of how much energy we are personally consuming.
It's like going back to the old ways, but as a modern human being, you know, I think that's really, really important, because so often the assumption is made that living off grid or living with reduced power means that I can't live a modern lifestyle. It's just not true.
Tal has shown us everything growing out on the veg patch and in the polytunnel, but this is the aftermath of everything. So all of the food that you grow gets stored in various places.
Yes.
What kind of things have we got here?
So we've got potatoes, that's all our winter store. We've got hazelnuts, we've got pumpkins, various varieties, onions, green tea. We've got our own tea bushes. I know.
I didn't know that green tea could grow here in climates like this?
Absolutely. Green beans that are frozen, gooseberries, raspberries and blackcurrants. And then we can use those for crumbles and jams and stuff in the winter.
Who was this?
So this was Mr. Togs. This was our goat.
Right.
I don't actually eat goat meat. I find it quite strong. But I do work with the skin.
Right.
And I make rawhide, I make drums, I make rattles, I make all sorts of different strange things. But Tao loves it. He loves goat meat and he eats meat. We eat meat.
What about here? We've got bits in jars.
Okay, so I haven't actually got any passata left, so tomato passata, which I'd normally have rakes of, but we're getting closer to spring now, and by this sort of time of year, most of the kind of jarred stuff has been gobbled up by my family.
Do you think you appreciate food more because of it? Because you're like, yes, we've got new tomatoes coming.
My supermarket, I'll go around the garden and then it's like, okay, what are we going to eat? Okay, so we're going to go for spag bol. All right, so let's have a look. What have we got? So I go around, I pick some oregano, pick some garlic, pick some onions, you know, and just pick the ingredients from my garden, and that's what we're going to eat.
How do you deal with food waste? What's your, I guess, your system for creating compost?
Yeah, we split it. We basically have uncooked food waste, so that goes into one bin, and then we have our cooked food into another. Raw food goes onto a compost heap, and then the worms do their thing. They just turn it into compost, and then we can put it on the beds, and of course then out of the waste we grow more food.
So those natural decomposers are really useful.
Yeah, totally. Worms are queen. They really are.
I don't have a polytunnel or even a garden, so what are my options? I'm hoping that the team here at the Centre for Alternative Technology in Wales will be able to help me find something more manageable. Petra, are worms a genuine real-life solution to helping with waste management at home?
Yeah, they're a big part of the process of composting.
Okay.
So anyone who has a fairly small space for a bin like this could get worms to help them with their waste management.
Okay, so before worms, we kind of need to know the basics of composting.
Right.
Let's do that first.
The first thing you do then is get your newspaper.
Yeah.
And just get it nice and soggy.
So this is the first layer of my worm trifle, it's just soggy newspaper.
I'm going to put some soil on here now. Mm-hmm. It sort of helps with it not falling through the holes. Tip that in.
Sort of, all of it?
No.
Okay.
No, I don't think we need quite that much. here we go. We're going to add some water to that.
Yep.
Like I said, we need a nice moist,
soggy base.
Yeah. Then we can start with the green ingredients, mm-hmm. the orange ingredients in this case.
And then this just keeps getting layered up, so you've got
basically,
your vegetable peeling, some more of that carbon-rich material.
Yes. The other things worms really like, alkaline pH, so it's always good to add some eggshells.
Okay, and what is it about the eggshells that help towards that pH?
Well, they've got calcium in the shells. This is something that I've started using recently. It's called Diatomaceous Earth.
And what's the point of this?
This will really help to keep flies from developing.
Okay.
Because flies tend to like decomposing material.
Right. So it's an insecticide, but it doesn't bother the worms?
No, not at all.
Right.
No. It's actually good for them. And then we're just going to cover this all with papers. I'm just using paper that you'd have at home. Maybe not such a big egg tray, but you know, the insides of kitchen roll, toilet paper.
This is the start of compost.
Yes.
At what point can you put worms in?
Well, we'll do that now. So as soon as you start digging down,
there's one. There's one.
Yeah.
There's a friend. Can I take this one?
Take it.
Come on, mate, we've got a new home for you. There we are.
Here we go, look at that.
Oh, that's a good bundle. Gosh, there are loads.
Yeah, yeah.
So I can just put these guys straight in?
Yeah, put them
in. All right then. Have
They'll
fun.
They'll be very happy here. So you could start off your compost in something like this.
Yeah. So I could pop this in my kitchen. Yeah. It would create a really nice fertiliser that I can use on my pot plants, my herbs, that I can then use in my cooking, and we start the full cycle again.
Exactly, yeah. So composting is all about cycles. We're trying to think about waste in a different way. It's not something we want to get rid of. Mm-hmm. It's something we want to incorporate back into, you know, what feeds us.
To find out more on how to live sustainably, you can watch the other videos in this series, and don't forget to subscribe.